changes in radius. Designers change the radius of a turn to put an additional twist in the action. Here are the basic kinds of radius and how to handle them. Constant radius turn. A constant radius turn neither increases, widens, nor decreases, tightens, as you go through it. As mentioned above, if it is a fairly long constant radius turn with no camber changes, you will eventually wind up on the inside of the turn for most of it. If it is a short hairpin, you may have other options as to how to set up the entry and exit. In a really tight hairpin, you must make an abrupt turning change. It should be done at the point at which you feel most confident about your exit. There is no rule as to how it should be done. If a constant radius turn has camber changes, it can act as a decreasing radius or as an increasing radius turn. For example, if the turn is banked on the entry and flattens out on the exit, it will have exactly the same effect on your bike as the decreasing radius. If it is flat on the entry and banked on the exit, it acts as an increasing radius. It is very common for amateurs and professionals as well to ride the turns the way they appear at speed and not the way they really are. It is very easy to have your attention stuck to the radius of a turn so you don't see the camber changes. Thus, knowing the location of the camber changes will help you greatly in a turn. Decreasing radius turns. This is a turn that tightens up as you go through it. In a decreasing radius turn, the designer tries to trick you into treating it as a constant radius, single apex turn. If you fall for that, you must do one of three things. 1. Run wide at the exit. 2. Lean the bike over more at the end of the turn. Or 3. Back off the gas so that 1 and 2 above don't happen. A decreasing radius turn has at least two apexes. Try to cheat the turn out of one apex and it will get you back with the other. In a decreasing radius turn, you must ride what is there. Don't try to make the turn into something it is not. Some misleading information has been circulating for years which says you late apex decreasing radius turns. This may be true in a very tight decreasing radius turn, but in a larger turn, you must double apex the turn. You can make the turn longer for yourself by taking a wide entry line. This keeps your speed up and cuts down on the abruptness of the actual steering change. A decreasing radius turn that is flat on the entrance and banked at the exit will act as an increasing radius or constant radius turn, depending upon the severity of the banking. If a turn is constructed so that it forces you to go slow at some point, you must decide where to go slow instead of letting the designer decide for you. By figuring a turn correctly, you ride the road does not ride you. If you make a big mistake in line, you have probably just been sucked into riding the turn the way it looks rather than the way it is. Here's what Eddie said about that. Some places, you have to use a real wide line so you don't scrub speed off. But not always. Increasing radius turns. This turn widens. Its angle becomes less severe as you go through it. An increasing radius gives you the safest feeling because you have room at the end to make changes and corrections. You can easily recover from going into an increasing radius turn too fast because you have plenty of room. An increasing radius turn can be changed dramatically by the camber of the road, just as a decreasing radius turn can be. If it is banked going in and flat or off camber at the exit, it will act as a constant radius or decreasing radius turn, depending upon how much negative camber it has. The radius of the turn is often second in importance to its camber. Series of turns. Two or more turns linked together in such a way as to influence each other are called a series of turns. They're usually designed to slow you down at a place where you otherwise could go faster. For example, the entry into a two-turn S is faster than the exit. If the entry is taken as fast as possible, it will spoil the exit. If the entry is approached with the exit in mind, the rider will sacrifice some speed going in for a more constant drive out of the turn. Often, this is a better strategy than having to back off and set up again for the exit. It is very distracting to make this kind of change in the second turn in a series. Kenny Roberts has often said that you must go slow in some places in order to go fast in others. His slow, of course, would put most of us into cardiac arrest. Here again, the designers attempt to lull us into taking action either too soon or too late. In some high-speed chicanes, being temperate with the throttle on the way in and setting up a smooth exit is worth over a second in lap time. Chicanes such as those at Pocono, Daytona, and Sears Point are good examples. Uphill, downhill, and crested turns. When a track changes in elevation, it can create some exciting changes in how it must be ridden. Uphill and downhill sections of a track don't pose any particular problem unless they're in conjunction with a tricky camber change, radius change, or both. Difficulties in up and down sections usually arise where there is a crest or sharp rise followed by a downhill. At this point, the bike will feel light and will actually be light on the pavement. Braking over a crested hill is tricky because the downward pressure of the bike is lessened. This results in less traction. Bull turns, such as corner one at Willow Springs, present a similar problem. As you exit the turn, the bike lightens up a bit, and powerful bikes tend to spin the tire as the bike comes out over the bowl's lip. A turn with a crest in the middle is also tricky because the bike tends to stand up and go towards the outside. Again, there's a loss of traction. It has the same effect as a short patch of off-camber road. It's best to go over a crested road as vertically as possible. Turn 7 at Mid-Ohio is a brilliant example of a crested turn. The crest is right in the middle. This is one of the favorite places to lose the back end at Mid-Ohio. The designer must still be grinning on that one. On uphill sections where you must brake, you have the advantage that you can stop or slow the bike faster than on flat or downhill sections. If the hill that you're braking on has a 15-degree slope, the force of gravity pulling you back and down gives you a 27% better stopping factor. You can use the brakes 27% harder without locking them up, and that's a lot. On a downhill section, the situation is reversed. The brakes lock more easily. The other possible problem with uphill, downhill, and crested roads is that bikes tend to wheelie over them. This isn't really a problem unless you have to make a turn while the front wheel is still in the air. Straight sections. These are straight portions of the track with no turn or changes to affect you. Straightaways are a great place to relax for a second or two. Check to see that you're breathing regularly. Riders often hold their breath during intense riding, which slows their efficiency. Lack of oxygen is one cause of muscle cramps while riding. The road you ride, whether it be public or racetrack, is made up of the five components: camber, radius, elevation, series of turns, and straights. How these components are combined determines your approach to riding them, not only where speed is the consideration, but for safety's sake as well. The purpose of a racetrack is to test and retest your riding skill. It is intended by the designers to be difficult. Your task is to unravel the mysteries of the construction by using your knowledge to your advantage. No amount of bravery will substitute for understanding, and no amount of suspension changes will entirely overcome the forces generated by these five components.